be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to worship this morning as we're gathered for a service of the Word. We'll be following divine service setting number 3. You may notice that at the end of the pews, the attendance books have returned. And if you would like to fill those out, we would appreciate it. It'll help us keep attendance. Also, this morning is a quarterly meeting, so please plan to stay after the service. We're not going to move into the fellowship area. We're going to stay right here and conduct the meeting. In our prayers this morning, in addition to those listed in the bulletin, we are continuing to pray for Lois Wagner as she remains hospitalized, and for Lori's brother Joseph Mangan, who has had successful hip surgery, and now we're just waiting to make sure that infection does not set in as it did the previous time. Let us now stand as we begin our worship, singing hymn 842, Son of God, Eternal Savior.
Sincerely repent of them, and I pray you will give your boundless mercy, and for the
the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Among their brothers, and I will put your words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them that I command him. And whoever will not listen to the word, he shall speak in my name. I myself require it of him. But the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name that I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods, the same prophet shall die. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle today is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 8, beginning at verse 1. Concerning food offered to idols, we know that of all of us possess knowledge. This knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. If anyone imagines that he knows something, he does not yet know as he ought to know. But if anyone loves God, he is known by God. Therefore, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that an idol has no real existence, and that there is no God but one. For although there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as indeed there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father whom all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom all things and through whom we exist. However, not all that possess this knowledge, but some, through former association with idols, eat food as really offered to an idol. And their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not commend us to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care of this right of yours. Does not someone become a stumbling block to the weak? For if anyone sees you have knowledge eaten in an idol's temple, will he not be encouraged, if his conscience is weak, to eat food offered to idols? And so by your knowledge, this weak person is destroyed. The brother whom Christ died, thus, sinning against your brothers and wounding their conscience when it is weak, your sin against Christ. Therefore, if food makes your brother stumble, I will never eat meat, lest I will make my brother stumble. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Will you stand as we sing Hallelujah?
Church,
mercy and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The text for the sermon this morning is the gospel reading, Jesus preaching in Capernaum. You may have gotten used to the way that I preach, just like you were probably very used to the way pastors here preached before me. There are those little stories that we all sprinkle into sermons to help illustrate the message. Perhaps an anecdote about a personal experience, maybe a reference to a movie or a well-known book, sometimes a cultural reference, or even better, a sports reference to relate God's constant grace or his unfailing power. Every pastor that you can remember had his own style of preaching, his particular cadence, his tone of voice, his choice of words, his use of illustrations and metaphors. Some pounded the pulpit when they preached the law of God. Others were soft-spoken but firm. But it was never about them. In fact, when it comes to the highlight of the sermon, God's gracious words of hope and forgiveness, we had better not be found standing in the spotlight, because it is all about Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. There's a point in every sermon when it's time to look away from the cares of this world, be it guilt and regret, anger or pain, fear or condemnation, and just look to Jesus as he brings his healing touch to every one of us. We as pastors are kind of like faithful sidekicks, like an Ed McMahon to a Johnny Carson, like Dear Watson to Sherlock Holmes. We can quote the master, but we're never going to be him. So I wonder how we would react if Jesus himself were to address us from the pulpit some Sunday. I would imagine that our initial shock would quickly give way to awe, and we would sit spellbound as the Lord personally delivered his promise of forgiveness of sins. But we have the advantage of knowing just where the message of Jesus is going to be completed, because we know him as the Christ, but people in early first century Palestine did not yet know that. And the scene in Mark's gospel this morning is a familiar one. Jesus is in the city of Capernaum, the place where he and his disciples are living. And on the Sabbath, he goes to the synagogue and he teaches them with authority. Although people are amazed at his teaching, Mark doesn't record any of his sermon for us. Instead, Mark directs our attention to an encounter that Jesus has with an unclean spirit. Now, it's not normal for the teacher to be heckled and even to be rebuked in worship. That encounter makes the worship service, which was comfortable and familiar to the people, suddenly awkward and very unfamiliar. But as the familiar Sabbath service takes a change in tone, we begin to see the whole extent of the power and the rule of Jesus Christ. So let's listen a little bit more closely to the language of this unclean spirit. The spirit confronts Jesus by crying out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." Notice how this unclean spirit is speaking in the plural, us. Mark clearly tells us the spirit is singular, as in it is an unclean spirit. And Jesus rebukes the spirit, and he commands it in the second person, singular. And yet the spirit insists in speaking in the plural. Now this could be a case where the spirit is one of many, like the legion of unclean spirits that possessed a man in another place. Or it could be that the spirit is speaking for a whole realm of unclean spirits, Or maybe the spirit is just trying to deceive Jesus, calling itself many, when it is indeed only one. I wonder, though, if the unclean spirit could be making a bolder claim. Is it possible that this spirit is claiming all the people in the synagogue as being its own? This unclean spirit already lays claim to this one man, and later will send him into convulsions. Is it possible the spirit sees things differently than we do? We look at the synagogue, and we see God's people gathering in worship. The spirit, however, may see the uncleanness in them and lay claim to all which is unclean as being its own. God's people have gathered in worship, and there is a war going on. And this war has two opponents. There is the kingdom of Satan, and there is the kingdom of God. And there is no middle ground. You're either in Satan's temporal kingdom of death, or you are in God's eternal kingdom of life. When the Spirit first appears in the story, Mark makes it sound like there is some sort of a middle ground. Mark says, and immediately, there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. It sounds as if the synagogue doesn't really belong to God or to Satan, but to the people of Capernaum. And the Spirit then makes a claim. Its claim is that all the people gathered there are his. They are unclean like he is, cannot be in the presence of the Holy One of God. And what does God have to do with those who are unclean? Absolutely nothing. And so the Spirit cries out and reveals that the people of Capernaum, gathered in worship, are under threat of being claimed by Satan. And it is then that Jesus reveals who he truly is. He's more than just a man from Nazareth. He's more than just a teacher with some authority. He is the Christ who comes to reclaim what belongs to him. This is, in fact, his synagogue, and these are his people. His rule is over all things, both visible and invisible. His power is without equal, and he has come into this world to fight against Satan and to defeat him. He will set free all of the people that Satan claims as his own. And so in very dramatic fashion, Jesus casts out the unclean spirit of this world. This poor man is no longer bound to follow the unclean urges of selfish deceit. The power of God's grace compels the evil one to loosen its grasp on this man's life. And at this moment, he is a free man. But there are more spirits lurking. We still walk through the valley of the shadow of death. How are the unclean to be made clean for good? How are the captives to be set free from evil? Well, that has a higher cost to Jesus. He will do it as decisively as he does here in the worship service of Capernaum. But in the end, it will be Jesus convulsing. And it will be Jesus crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me? As he hangs on the cross, carrying the whole debt of sin and the damning burden of uncleanness that separates us from God's holy presence. That will be the gracious work that only Jesus can do, bearing the curse of our filthiness on the cross, offering himself as the holiest sacrifice so that he might rise from death in the grave and convey the blessing of God's holiness upon us, which means we are now clean. For almost a year now, we've been infected with the debilitating effects of this COVID-19 virus. One of the things that has happened is that it has changed the way we view our ability to gather in worship. We may feel unclean ourselves Or we may look around at others and wonder if they're carrying this disease that we've come to fear. We want to worship joyfully and freely, but we still feel as if a spirit of uncleanness is hanging over us. We remember the days of fearless worship and our unity in word and in sacrament, and we've begun to see why this is so truly a gift. Mark's gospel this morning takes us one step further. He reveals the divine gift of worship. This is not our church. We are Christ's church. The one we worship is the one who has come to rescue us from the power of Satan. We live in the midst of this battle. Satan seeks to lay claim on our lives, but the one who fights for us is the valiant one, Jesus. Christ the Savior has come today, and he claims us, all of us, as his own. Whatever spirit of this world is claiming you to be his own, you have been released from its grip by the atoning death of Jesus. And you have become more than just a conqueror, not because of your willpower, not because of your sacrifice, but by the determination of Jesus to spend his life for yours, to scoop up your sins out of the baptismal font, and to give you his righteousness in return. As Thomas remarked at the sight of his risen living master, "My Lord and my God." When you heard the words of my voice absolve you of your sins this morning, know that those words proclaimed nothing about me. Those were the words of my Lord and your Lord, our God, who commands the unclean spirit within us to come out of us. In God's divine service, there is the familiar yet dramatic encounter between Jesus and our unclean tempter and accuser. We have been set free now, free to worship God in spirit and in truth. Amen. Congregation, please stand as we sing the offertory.
Strengthen those whose faith is weak, and when necessary,
bold to forego convenience and attest the truths of our most holy faith with heart and action. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, give health and success to our president and governor, our legislators and judges, and all who serve for our governance and protection. Make them high in purpose, wise in counsel, and unwavering in duty. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son cast out unclean spirits and taught with authority. He is the great physician of body and soul. Have mercy on those who are sick, distressed, in danger, or facing any need, especially Dick Brown and Amy Bullard, Evan Bruning and Jen Bush, Connie Davis, Linda Elliott, Larry Fuller, Denise Jambroni, Dorothy Haas, Trevor Hollenbeck, Dick Hoof, Matthew Jackson, Don Beats, Joseph Mangan, Emma, Todd Payne, Dick Redunz, Norma Raybould, Tom Wolf, Nancy Smith, Joanne Wagner, and Lois Wagner. Sustain them with patience, trusting in your merciful care, and graciously reveal them, Lord, in your mercy. All these things, and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again, and now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever.
Amen.
Taught by our Lord and trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Faithful God, whose mercies are new to us every morning, we humbly pray that you would look upon us in mercy and renew us by your Holy Spirit. Keep safe our going out and our coming in, and let your blessing remain with us throughout this day. Preserve us in your righteousness, and grant us a portion in that eternal life which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you